Hi, it's Kiefin Lobates here, and in today's video I'm going to look at the Mina Protocol. I guess that's how it's pronounced, because a friend of mine who shall remain nameless had bought some tokens in that project and was asking if it's actually a bona fide blockchain. And I also noticed that I think Kraken and Coinbase are listing the Mina token as of today. So what's this protocol all about? Well, it's trying to solve the blockchain space problem, the fact that a blockchain takes up more and more space over time. And if you go and look, for example, at the Bitcoin blockchain, it's at about a third of a terabyte in size. If you look at Ethereum and you want to have a full archive node, i.e. a history of everything that's ever happened, you're at well at over a terabyte of data. Now, firstly, I have to say that I don't think the space that is used by storing a blockchain is a particularly big problem, in that you just need to go and look at the Chia network and you'll see that exabytes are being used for that. And the data being stored there has no purpose other than to prove that you are the next person who's allowed to claim the block reward. So the space storage issue with blockchain actually is one about incentivization. If there's, for some reason, a reward available in order to host a copy of the blockchain, then you've got incentives to do so and space doesn't become an issue. As I said, Chia proves that. At the moment, there's actually no financial incentive to run a Bitcoin node. The financial incentive is to run a miner instead. Now, of course, a phone can't store a third of a terabyte of data very easily. So if you're looking to solve the problem of storing a blockchain on a phone, then space does become an issue. And this, I guess, is kind of the angle that Mina is aiming at. The idea that you can have a complete copy of the blockchain on your phone, even though it's only got 32 or 64 gigabytes of storage space. And Mina makes the claim on the website where they're talking about their protocol in layman's terms that you can use their system in order to store a blockchain in only 22 kilobytes, which sounds like quite an extravagant claim. So initially I was skeptical and I thought, well, it's worth digging into this further. They do provide a technical paper. It's full of a load of maths, so for 99% of the people out there, that paper is basically going to be incomprehensible and unreadable. And I have to confess, I started digging my way through it and got about a third of the way through and then thought, I really have other things to spend my time on than trying to understand what the three people who are listed as authors on the paper are on about. The paper's presented in a typical academic style, so it's a latex style paper. It looks like something that would be published in a journal or an academic publication. And I think I'll go back to the layman's term website and talk a bit about transactions and the ledger. So if you have a ledger that keeps track of accounts and balances and transactions, you need to have everything available because you need to know who transacted, when they transacted, and how much they transacted. And if you don't have that data in plain text, there are, for example, cryptocurrencies out there like Monero or Zcash, which hide that information but still provide various proofs that someone has the required balance in order to transact, for example. The thing is, if you go and look at Zcash, you'll find that what is called an unshielded or an open transaction is about a quarter the size of a transaction that is hidden using ZK-SNARKs or zero knowledge proofs. And there's a reason for that. If you think about information theory, the most succinct or compact way to store some information, if the information is essentially random, is by actually having that information. If you want to gain some extra anonymity, that is going to cost you. That seems common sense. So back to the Mina protocol. The problem with the Mina protocol is that the claims as are made on the website go against information theory. And of course, most people aren't information theorists. Most people haven't heard of Shannon's source coding theorem, for example. But there's this theorem in information theory that says that gives you a limit as to how much you can compress data. If you have truly random data where you can't predict what the next bit is going to be, then there is no compression algorithm. If you have some repetitive patterns, then you can compress information down. But there is actually an intuitive proof that you can't have a compression algorithm for data that works for all kinds of data and makes all kinds of data smaller. Because if you, say, have a whole load of 1 gigabyte blocks of random data, and you have a mechanism for compressing 1 gigabyte down to 1 megabyte, well, there are going to be 1,000 million of these 1 gigabyte blocks that could exist. And if you've only got 1 million indexes to store them, there's going to be collisions. There will be bigger blocks that will compress down to the same smaller value. It's sort of like having a restaurant with a certain number of seats and potentially 1,000 times as many customers as there are seats. There will come a point where there just will not be any seats available. So when you look at information theory and you look at the claims on the website, the two don't match. Now, the Mina people give an analogy that tries to explain why they think they can do this. And the analogy they give is that you consider the first block to be a picture of an elephant, and then the next block, instead of storing all the information, you take a picture of a person holding the picture of the elephant, and then you take a picture of a person holding the picture of a person holding the picture of the elephant, and so on. And the idea is, just like the intro sequence to Modern Family, a comedy show from America, where they do exactly that in the title sequence, you'll have all the information of the current situation and all the previous situations in that picture. But when you think about it, if that picture is 22 kilobytes in size, which is a pretty poor digital camera given the megapixel size most cameras have, as you start taking more and more pictures of pictures of pictures, the earlier pictures in those pictures will be shrinking. They'll be getting smaller and smaller, and eventually they will just be 1 pixel in size. So you can't store an image of an elephant in 1 pixel, and of course eventually that 1 pixel will disappear. So clearly you can't store an entire 100 gigabyte or 300 gigabyte blockchain in 22 kilobytes. And when you dig into the paper, you'll discover that actually they're not claiming to have the whole blockchain in 22 kilobytes. What they are doing is they have prover nodes which actually keep a complete copy of all the transactions, as you'd expect from information theory, and those nodes provide proofs that they have the complete copy of information, and it's those proofs that are small, that are 22 kilobytes. So then you've got to start asking yourself, well, isn't this kind of like trusting a third party to be honest? You could do this with Bitcoin. You could just have 4 nodes dotted around the globe for redundancy purposes in case one goes down, and we could all just trust that they keep an accurate copy of the blockchain for us. It's really no longer decentralized at that point. So when you dig further into the paper again, you discover that they're using a rather complicated zero knowledge proof scheme in order to make the nodes do some work to produce these proofs that show that they have a complete copy of the node, which means that you're again effectively shunting off Bitcoin proof of work type stuff in a different format. It's not just lots and lots of double hashings of blocks, but it is a computer processing intensive method. So you're shunting a kind of proof of work off onto a limited number of prover nodes, and then the rest of the world has their phones with these small copies of those proofs on their device. So the more I dig into it, the more I think, well, firstly, the claims on the website are not backed up by information theory or even by the actual technical paper that they're presenting. Secondly, they've just shifted the problem from individuals having copies of nodes to a few select prover nodes. And then there is still a form of proof of work required in order to ensure that those prover nodes are relatively honest. And Maybe if you dig into the prover nodes, you'll find that there are actually hacks or ways of getting around the honesty of the system, thereby enabling double spend attacks by those prover nodes. I don't know. I have a limited amount of time in my life and I can't be bothered to spend all of it on digging into these kind of papers. If I'm going to spend an intensive amount of time looking at some complicated mathematics, I want to do it on something that from the very start I have a positive feeling that this is actually a real contribution to the blockchain space, not something that from the site's own explainers gives me a kind of dodgy feeling. So in this video we've covered a few interesting things. I think the reason why you need to have a complete copy of the ledger, the reason why there is a limit to compression, and the fact that there is no magic middle out compression algorithm that somehow can shrink anything and everything down to a tiny size, and looking at the system, the fact is that what is technically implemented according to the claims of the technical paper doesn't match the claims made on the layman's terms website, which should set off alarm bells. So it's a cryptocurrency just because I feel that it is highly, highly likely that the claims are not actually met by the implementation. Doesn't of course mean that people won't go crazy about it and the tokens won't shoot through the roof. I mean, we live in a world where a joke dog-based coin now has real value, so rationality in some sense has gone out the window in the crypto space. But people like myself do the best we can to try and get these things back down to earth, I think I'll wrap it up here. Leave some comments below to let me know what you think. Bye for now.